Good afternoon. Silence. Well, good afternoon, everybody. Today, I have the pleasure to introduce you Rubén Moreno-Bote. He was already here, if you remember, 4 years ago, something like that. So he was giving us a seminar as well at that time. Rubén studied physics. He got a PhD degree from the Universidad Autónoma de Madrid, under the supervision of Néstor Parga, working already in neuroscience modeling. From 2005 to 2008, he had a postdoc contract at the University of New York. And then from 2008 to 2011, he was a research associate in the Department of Brain and Cognitive Science in the University of Rochester in the United States. And since then, he has a Ramonica Hall position working at it's a hospital, the San Juan de Deu.
It's a Fundación.
It's a hospital. And his interest is in general in computational neuroscience, but he's also collaborated with experimental groups. And I can say that from September, he will have a primary position in the Universidad Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona, with a position that is created half and half between the government of Catalonia and the university itself, something that we don't have here.
Yeah. Only Catalonia has that.
I know. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me, for taking me here to give this talk in this place. It's really a pleasure to come to the IFISC because I know that here very good science is being done, and in particular in computational neuroscience, which is the field that I'm interested in. And I highly appreciate the science and research that is also done in the university. Psychology are also really very highly appreciated, so I'm very happy to be here and to talk to all of you. So today I'm going to talk about our latest work on information limiting correlations. So probably many of you know, but neural responses in cortex are highly variable. So if we take a neuron in primary visual cortex, these neurons like responding to this kind of a stimulus. This is a drifting grating moving in a particular direction. Upon presenting this stimulus in the so-called receptive field of the cell, the area of the space that is going to make the neuron fire, you can get, if you recall from this neuron, you will get a sequence of spikes. So each dot represents a spike, a unique event that is going to be transmitted downstream in the brain. And as you can see here, there is a little bit of structure in this spike train, maybe with some parts here, with some clustering there and here. But the surprising observation is when you repeat exactly the same experiment, now you're recording the same neuron sitting in the same brain, in the same animal, and using exactly the same stimulus, in a second trial, you get a completely different response, as you can see here. And every time that you repeat this experimentation with exactly the same stimulus and in the same neuron, you get a unique sequence of spikes. And only when you start to see all these trials at the same time, so this is time, and this is many, many trials, only when you see all these at the same time, what you can start to see is that this neuron like firing at the particular phases of the periodic movement of this drifting grating, like these bands and these bands. So this doesn't look like good design for a sensory system, because a sensory system like a primary visual cortex that is sitting here, what you may assume that it's doing is transforming information from your retina and transmitting this information in a very reliable way downstream. But this is not what is happening here, as you can see here. In fact, if you were about to buy a computer and while you are trying to understand the specifications of this computer, the vendor tells you that each time that you press a key, you will get a completely different response, probably you won't buy this computer. And yet, this is the regime in which your brains are working. Your brains are working in a regime in which responses won't never happen twice, the same, identical responses. You will have unique responses to very similar stimuli. So this is a challenge in the field, and many people have tried to characterize the statistical properties of this variability of the responses. And this is the classical report by Sheldon and Newsom, but there are many, many others that you can take. And to simplify the description, this is just the response of another neuron in sitting somewhere else in MT, an area that codes a motion direction, but it's not very important. But what you have here is essentially the same, is the response of this neuron over time across many, many trials. And you can compute the average activity of this cell as a function of time, and it fluctuates widely because the stimulus is, has energy that fluctuates quite widely. This is a random dot stimulus. And then, you want to analyze this in from some statistical point of view. And of course, the first order approach is to focus on regions of time where the statistics is pretty constant. Somehow, the frame rate in this area, in this window, is pretty much constant. So here you have the zoom region here. The frame rate of this neuron is constant, 100 hertz, something like that. And now you can assume that you are in a stationary process, and you can use some statistical descriptions like the distribution of the interspike intervals, which interspike intervals will be the distance between consecutive spikes. And this typically follows like this gamma-like distribution that some people try to fit it with exponential. It's like a really very first order approximation to the type of variability there that you can see. And this other interesting observation, which is that the variance of the spike count, if you count spikes at different times of this in this process, and you plot the variance of the count as a function of the mean of the count of the events, it typically is very close to a straight line. So this is indicating, and this is a result that has been shown by many, many authors before and after these authors, that neural variability is close to Poisson. It has the essential ingredients to be close to a Poisson process. It's not a Poisson process, of course, but to a first order approximation is something like that. So this is the first interesting observation for today's talk. The second interesting observation, initial observation for today's talk, is that this variability is correlated among cells. It's not independent across cells. So recently, with the advent of multi-electrode recording techniques, now we can record the activity of many neurons simultaneously in cortex. And this is, and you can get activity patterns like this. So this will be the population response as a function of time. So here you have every entry here is a neuron number, and every dot corresponds to the spike of that particular neuron. And you can see, you can start to ask questions as to, for instance, what is the statistical properties of these responses. And ultimately, what you want to do is to understand these properties in connection to the behavior of a fully behaving animal or a human. Some animal making a choice about the random dot stimulus direction and trying to correlate the choices of this animal with hidden variables that still need to be uncovered, we don't know them very well, that inform the animal to perform a particular task or to perceive something in particular. And the most general observation, and this is widely observed in the literature, is that neurons, if you pick up any two neurons here in this population, the most standard observation is that these neurons are correlated. They are not independent. They do something at the same time, somehow. And this is just the cross-correlation function, which shows the joint probability density of having two spikes from two neurons emitted with some time lag difference. A peak at zero time lag means that these neurons tend to fire synchronously, somehow. They tend to loosely fire synchronously. And the width of this peak indicates the temporal resolution of this synchronization. You can see here it's of the order of 10 milliseconds. So this is the typical precision of the synchronization process in this system. So people have tried to understand further the statistical properties of correlation, because we know that they are important. And probably, or some of at least some of you have heard about a very hot debate that is in the literature right now, which is the following one. So in the literature, people like Adam Cohn, which is a collaborator of me, and many other people, have computed the Pearson correlation coefficient of the spike counts of two nearby cells. So this is just a measurement of synchronization, but where you integrate all times. So essentially, it doesn't tell you the precision of the synchronization. It tells you the strength of the synchronization. And across many experimental setups and preparations, the common observation has been that for similarly tuned neurons, the correlation coefficient is 0.1. This result has been very recently challenged by the group of Tolias et al, where they have found that in very similar conditions, in V1, in monkeys, very similar experimental preparations, the correlation coefficients that they have found are of the one order of magnitude weaker than those previously found. And so this looks like a very interesting debate, because you want to know what is the strength of synchronization between cells in cortex, that this maybe tell you something about information and these questions. But the topic of today's talk is really understanding why should we care about the size of correlation. So is this actually an interesting question per se, or, yeah?
Is correlation of OI set to 1?
Yes, the Pearson correlation coefficient, yeah.
Because 0.1 is already small. I mean, of course, 0.01 is much.
Yeah, it's small, small compared to 1, but.
It's a sort of small correlation.
It's small, but it's visible. I mean, you will plot, you will see it with your naked eye on a plot. So it's not something that you have to do statistics to see this number. Yeah.
This is for direct neighboring neurons, or like?
Neighboring and typically with similar tuning. Tuning here means that they tend to prefer the same orientation, for instance, of the grating. If they have similar tuning, they tend to respond to the similar stimuli property, then this is the correlation. Otherwise, the correlation is slightly weaker than this. Between the similarity and correlations?
No, I mean between the two neurons. Are they connected? Are they nearest neighbors? Are they?
For this data, they don't know. So they can be correlated because they have direct connections or because they have indirect connections. This is just empirical observation. But the question for today, for you, is should we care about this question? That's the question. So, and this is why I believe that people in my field is interested in this question. So let me show first to give you the intuition why people are interested in this question. And this is why we believe that people are interested in this question. So let's assume that you have you prefer a spiking network model. It can be any model that you like. And let's assume that you run this network and you get a correlation coefficient of 0.1. Okay. So now let's assume that there is a decorrelation mechanism, something that allows you to change something in this network in such a way that the final outcome is a network whose correlation coefficient is one order of magnitude weaker than the previous one. For instance, maybe you change the lateral connections, the strength of inhibition to excitation, you change something. So is this good or not? So this is a very famous plot in our field, which is a Nature paper by Sohari et al, which just limit very, very, very obvious statistical analysis. There is nothing really very smart there, but the implications are kind of like interesting. So this is a very straightforward plot. So what they are showing here is the signal-to-noise ratio of a homogeneous population of neurons. This is the signal-to-noise ratio is a measure of the information that you can get in this population about some sensory variable that this the population is encoded, like the orientation of the grating in the previous example. The signal-to-noise ratio is a function of the number of neurons in your population and for different values of the correlation coefficients that you can see here. So obviously, if neurons are independent, the correlation coefficient is 0, then the more neurons you have, the better signal you have. So you're going to be able to estimate the signal that is encoded in this population better and better. But as soon as you have very tiny correlations, like something like 0.05, this information rapidly saturates as a function of the number of neurons. And even for populations larger of 100 neurons, it doesn't make any improvement to have a bigger population. So you really get to saturation very, very quickly as a function of the number of neurons. So using this picture, now let's think what this implies. So let's assume that there is a decorrelation mechanism that moves your network from a correlation coefficient of 0.1 to 0.01. So what this picture will suggest is that then you move vertically here, and then your information, the amount of information that you can extract about the sensory variable increases. So it looks that the decorrelation, it will be good if you have a way to decorrelate, to lower the synchrony in your network. It looks that you should be able to improve the signal to noise ratio. You will be moving in this direction. You will increase the information. And as a consequence, it looks that there is a sensible thing to do, to try to decorrelate neural networks, to get more and more information about sensory variables. So therefore, the correlation appears to be a universal recipe for increasing information. So if you have a network and you decorrelate, it looks that you have a winner. You are going to get more information. But the question is whether this is really so. And we're going to look at this. So in the field, there is a bunch of theoretical papers that they have studied the statistical properties, in particular the correlations, of this type of network. So just let me summarize the type of network. You have an input layer here that projects to a excitatory pool and inhibitory pool. The sizes of these populations can be different. I just put n just to simplify notation. There can be different sizes for excitation and inhibition. And all of these works, if you look at the literature, they have been playing the following game, which is increasing the size of this network. You increase the size of this network to very large networks and trying to understand the statistical properties of this network as it becomes very, very large. And there are two main reasons to do this. The first reason is that, of course, in cortex, networks are very large. So we are talking about millions of cells. So it makes sense to try to understand your physical system in some thermodynamic limit. So this is the first reason. But the second reason, and I think that this is a blame for my colleagues, is that when you do this analysis, actually things simplify. Because you can use mean field analysis, you can use the nicest tools of statistical physics, and you can get to understand quite well the statistical properties of those systems, very large systems. So the common observation, the common result across all the previous works that I presented to you, is that as you perform this manipulation, as you take this network to be very, very large, the correlation coefficient, the average correlation coefficient in the network scales 1 over n. This is a very standard result. It happens regardless of the density of the connections, of the whether you have a sparse connectivity, dense connectivity. It's a really very general result.
May I ask?
Yeah, sure.
What assumptions enter into this? So for example, how do you scale the network? Are the individual nodes homogeneous or heterogeneous?
That can be heterogeneous. You can use one, the connectivity strength can be weak as 1 over n. The connectivity strength can be very strong, like 1 over the square root of n. Different type of scalings, in all the cases, you get this this result. So it's a very general result, okay? Of course, it breaks in some conditions, but overall, there are big portions of the your parameter space where you will get this result. And there are very big portions of your parameter space. So this is very interesting, because if this happens, what this is telling you is that as you have a bigger and bigger network, neurons become more and more independent. So it looks like this is a very interesting thing to have, because if you connect this with the previous result of information, this looks like something sensible, something that you want to have. And not only that, but actually we believe, and many people believe, that this regime is what you will find in cortex. Cortex is finding in a regime in which correlations are weak, I mean 0.1 or some other lower values, but there is not working in a regime in which the correlations are very high. This is called the asynchronous regime, or weakly synchronous regime. However, and these are the major problems of this type of theoretical analysis, this decorrelation mechanism has been shown to work only when input information increases without bound as the size n increases. So what do I mean by this? So let's look at this network. So something that these works assume and I didn't say is that the input layer, this one here, of course, scales with the size of the network. So one thing that you are doing in this network is taking also the input layer and scaling it down, up, to very large numbers. And the other assumption is that neurons in this input layer are independent. Given the stimulus, they're conditionally independent. You can think of like a retina. Given the stimulus, they're independent. There is photon noise, but this photon noise is independent across cells in your retina. So what this means in terms of information? So what is the hidden assumption that you have in this type of network? The hidden assumption is the following. So let's compute, just get an estimate of how much information we are throwing into the network. So let's compute the signal-to-noise ratio. Let's assume that the input layer is continuous, So if we can compute the total activity of this input layer on average, it's going to be n times the average activity of a single cell in the input layer. We can compute also the variance of the sun, and this is n times the variance. And of course, the signal to noise ratio, which is the ratio between the mean and the square root of the variance, scales as one the square root of n. So essentially, what you are assuming in this with this type of analysis, in this type of mean field analysis, is that as you increase your size of your network, when you take the thermodynamic limit n going to infinity, what you are assuming is that information, input information is grown without limits. So this is the assumption. And if you are you as my colleagues, they are not even aware that they are throwing into this assumption in this network. So, and why this is a problem, because you can say, I really want to understand this type of systems. But what do we believe that this is a problem? This is a problem, well, this is the conclusion, input information increases without bound, but the problem is that in real world situations, input information is fixed. So there are many examples that you can consider, visual system, auditory, the auditory system, for instance. If you want to extract information about the speech of a friend of you in a party, because of the mixing of the voices of the people in the party, because of the echoes of the walls and the floors, and because of the properties of the physical media and the limitations of your sensory apparatus, for all these reasons, the information that you are going to be able to extract about the speech of your friend is going to be limited. And no matter how big is your brain or your cochlea is, the amount of information that you can extract is going to be finite. Okay, so this is a hard constraint of the nervous system. Input information is finite. Okay, so instead of trying to understand with beautiful mathematical theories and analysis the statistical properties of this type of networks, what instead should we do is trying to understand the statistical properties, because it's an interesting question, of networks where the input layer, in other words, where the input information remains finite. So yeah, you are allowed to take a thermodynamic limit if you want here, but keep the input layer fixed, meaning keep the input information that you are throwing into the system fixed. And now, of course, the questions are the same. We can ask exactly the same question. Does decorrelation improve information in this setup? Namely, can I change now the connectivity in this network and increase information? And what type of correlations limit information? These are the two main questions that we want to address that are actually borrowed from the previous, from the previous works.
So in this context, what does it mean improve information? The quantity of information is fixed. So you cannot increase that quantity because the input information is the total input information is fixed. So what do you want to improve?
Maybe there is information loss in this network and you want to minimize the information loss. Of course, you cannot go beyond the input information. But maybe you want to, this is the question, you want to minimize information loss. That would be like interesting goal. But this, what you should understand is that this question was not even sensible in the previous setup. In the previous setup, mixing the argumentation about correlations and information, it was meaningless because as you were changing the properties of your network, you were also changing the properties of your input. So now these questions are they are meaningful at this point. And we are going to address those questions.
Same question, yeah. Like I don't really understand. What information are we talking about? The information contained in the network or the information amount of the input information that you find in your network?
So you can assume that there is an input to this network, to the input layer, like the orientation, this network is encoding the orientation of the stimulus,
right.
And you want to know how much information about orientation is in this network.
How much of the input information is contained?
Yeah,
in
yeah. Okay. I mean, in other words, is there information loss or, yeah.
Sorry, but in fact, so far I haven't seen any information formula. Are you talking about energy?
No, we're going to be talking specifically about facial information.
Okay.
But this is very general.
Because the scaling of sum of n, number of spikes looks more like energy, but you see that later it will be...
Yeah, we're going to be talking about facial information, yeah.
Okay.
So this is the outline, and the two first main results that I'm going to show you. Packet neural networks transmit virtually all input information, so there is no information loss, which is a rather surprising result because neural networks are highly nonlinear, And we're going to show you the examples of those. And as a conclusion, noise decorrelation does not imply information improvement. So let's see these two main results to start with just an illustration. So we have developed a full theory for a specific type of spiking networks that we can talk later if you want about the details. So let me just give you the hints of this result. So of course we consider a recurrent network of spiking neurons connected in some arbitrary way. And each neuron, for simplicity, we are going to assume that each neuron is receiving some signal from the external world. It can be the orientation of the grating, can be anything. In addition to this constant signal, it's receiving some shared noise, some noise that is going to be introduced in every neuron. And in addition, every neuron is receiving some independent contribution that is private to that particular neuron. So this is a very simplistic scenario, but it's the one that they can use to really explain this in a nice way for the audience. So but the results are much more general than this, okay? So this defines my input into the network. And now, of course, I'm going to have an output response, a sequence of spikes of my network, which are coming from the dynamics of highly nonlinear dynamics of this system. And what is the system that I'm going to analyze? The system that I'm going to analyze analytically, and actually we have analytical proofs for this system, is a network of non-leaking integrated-fire cells. Like you have here, the voltage, the derivative of the voltage increases with the current. Whenever the voltage reaches a threshold, there is a spike, and then the voltage is reset to a lower value and going on, integrating the further currents. And the current is the sum of the recurrent inputs, modeled as a delta function, but this can be much more general, plus the signal, plus the two external contributions. So this is just one example, okay? And we can prove the full theory for this system, and I'm going to show you a simulation results for the leaking integrated-fire cell. That there are, we cannot prove things analytically, but we can check it, the generality of the results numerically. So one of the basic questions here is how much information, how well I can estimate the stimulus S that was used to activate this network from the spike counts, from the spiking activity of this network. So this is a quite interesting question. And the first thing that we want to know is how much information we are throwing into the network. We want to know how much information is in the network. And how much information is going to be characterized by the error that you will make to estimate S if you have access to every single current that is coming in into every neuron from the external world. If you know all these currents, you will know how much information, the optimal amount of information that you can get, the maximum amount of information that you can get, no matter what you do. And this is the reconstruction error, which is going to be the sum of two contributions. One is the shared noise. So no matter what do you do here, any smart decoder, whatever you want to apply here, because you have this shared noise, your error in the estimate of S is going to be limited by this shared noise. And there is a second contribution that is the independent noise, which is going to be scaled down by the number of neurons. So of course, as you have more and more neurons in the input, and if you have access to the currents in the input, you just can average them out, and this signal is going to, the error of this signal is going to decay as 1 over, the square error is going to decay as 1 over n. So this is going to vanish eventually for large n. But here, what we introduce by heart, and we have a very good control of, is the amount of information. So we know that no matter what we do with this network, there is going to be some finite information that is coming in, and it's not going to be increasing with the size of the network. And the interesting question is how well we can reconstruct the signal S if we look at the spiking activity of this network. And here, because of the nonlinearity of this system, because it has a hard spiking threshold, it has a reset, you might expect that there is information loss. Because it's a nonlinear system. It's a highly nonlinear system. So what else you would expect? There is information loss. So let's compute what is this reconstruction error. So we're going to use very simple decoders. So we're going to look at just the spike counts of every neuron in a time window t. And this is a number, n. in the time window t that is different for every neuron in my population. So I have essentially a vector of spike counts across my population. And my decoder is going to be very simple to start with. My decoder is going to be just a linear combination of these spike counts. So the estimate, I want to estimate the input signal, is going to be just a linear, a weighted sum of these activities of my population. Okay? And of course, what I can do is to optimize, to minimize the variance of this estimator. If I minimize the variance of this estimator, I will get the lowest possible reconstruction error. And I want to know how well I can reconstruct the input. So when you do the math, surprisingly, what you find is that the output reconstruction error is pretty much identical to the input reconstruction error plus some small contribution that decays as one of the square root of t. So if you have large enough windows, you don't have any information loss. So this is a very interesting result, and it's kind of like challenging because it's a nonlinear system. You have chaotic dynamics in this system, and yet the system is able to transmit all information that is coming in. There is no information loss in this system.
This assumes that the input signal is constant in time.
It's constant in time.
Infinite time to measure the input signal.
Yeah, yeah.
While in the output, you measure toward the final time t.
Yeah.
So, and the difference basically is k with t, which means that if at the very end you were measuring over infinite time also, there would be zero.
Not necessarily. There is information. Yeah, but then you will change the slopes. So the error will go to zero, of course, but the rate which is goes to zero is worse than in the input. And here what we're seeing is that the rate in which this converges is exactly the same. So there is no information loss. Actually, it has a further implication that a little bit...
Are you going to give an example of what is the input or what you measure the output later?
Well, this is the example that I'm going to give. So, so let me repeat this because it's important that you get this one. So the input is this input.
But well, how does the signal look like?
It's a variable. It's a variable. And it's a constant. So it's a constant signal.
It's a bias current.
Bias current.
For instance.
And the sigma, what is the
and
sigma?
And then they have noise.
The variance of the noise.
But actually, this result, so this is the example that I'm going to give. But the theory is, holds for multidimensional signals and changing signals as long as the change is not too fast with the time constants of the network. So it will hold for very, very general setup. But this is the example that I'm going to give. So now let's go to the second main conclusion, which is that the size of collision does not matter. So the implication of this analysis is that regardless of the connectivity of this network, you won't lose information, which is kind of counterintuitive. So you cannot optimize information because almost whatever you do here is going to be keeping pretty much information that you can extract from this network. So it has a very nice conclusion. Corollary, sorry.
In this case, you assimilate or you identify information as the value s, which is a constant number.
Mm-hmm.
Now, any way to codify information usually is with bits, so something has to be changed between 0 and 1, or between two levels, or weighted in a given way, whether it is whatever, return to 0, or return to 0, any sort of modulation. So, in a constant, in something which is constant, somehow there is no information. If you want to make
No.
The standard information of a constant signal is...
No, you can define feature information for a constant variable. And it's essentially how well you can reconstruct that given the statistics statistical properties of your system.
But that variable is constant in time, does not contain any recipient information.
A constant signal does not contain
information. It contains information. No, that's not true. So this can be for
in the value, but that value has no information because the information is on the chain.
No, but this is information about S. I mean, there is no information about something like that. Is what is the information is how well you can reconstruct S from the activity of your network. If S is of a gradient, it's a really very important variable for a monkey, or like to know whether the next branch where it's going to be jumping to is like this or like that. and this is, and from some time window, that signal is constant. You can assume that it's constant within some limit. I mean, you can define official information about the continuous variables, so there's no problem with that. So let me keep going. So one of the conclusions of this analysis is interesting, which is the following. So now what I can do is change the connectivity in this network, okay? And when I change the connectivity in this network, I have different type of networks. One with very weak correlations, and another one with very strong correlations, and also I can change the size of my network. So here I have three families of networks. And these open circles corresponds to the simulations of non-leaking integrated fire cells, and full lights corresponds to the prediction. And these full circles corresponds to the, with the same parameters, the result with a leaking integrated fire cell. And as you can see, that there's a good match between the theory and both leaky and non-leaky networks when the correlations are weak, which is kind of what you also would expect. So the important message here is that actually, by changing the connectivity between cells in this network, if we look at the network with a larger size, which is 500 cells here, we actually were able to change the correlation, the average correlation coefficient between cells in this neuron quite a lot. So for the network with weak correlations, the correlation coefficient is 0.01, which is red. And for the green one, the correlation coefficient is 0.1. So this is actually the range of correlations that we have shown experimentally, that people are debating whether correlations are 0.01 or 0.1. So here we can get this range of correlations by changing some connectivity strengths on links in this network. So what do you expect here in terms of information? You will get higher information here about this constant signal or higher information over there. If you understood the previous analysis telling you that all information that was coming in went through the network, then you immediately will say, yeah, don't show me anymore. I know that this is going to be, information is going to be independent of this. You showed that before. But we did the simulations for several situations. So here we have information, which is the official information, as a number of neurons. The true input information is this black line here. The saturation level of the information is in red, and that corresponds to simulation results. What you can see, when you are playing with non-leaking integrated firing cells, the information that you can extract from linear decoders is pretty much very close, and there's only numerical finite size windows, finite size effects, is very close to the true input information. And this was so regardless of the size of the correlation. So here you can change one order of magnitude the synchronization strength in this network, and yet the amount of information that you were able to extract from this network was pretty much unchanged. And only when you play with leaking integrated fire cells, a little bit more complicated neural networks, there is a small effect on information loss. So if you see for the weaker correlation network, there is a little bit of more information than for the network with strong correlations, but this goes away as you have more and more neurons. So if any, correlations only affect very little the amount of information that you can extract about the sensory variables from neural networks. Really very, very far compared to what you will have predicted from this plot. From this plot, a change of correlation of 0.01 to 0.015 will have suggested that you could have increased your amount of information by several orders of magnitude. And this is something that literally doesn't happen in this type of networks, and we believe that this is really very general result, and we have done extensive numerical analysis for this. So to conclude, the size of collisions does not matter when it comes to information per se. So which means that this picture, of course, is wrong. So we know that you cannot go there to a neural network, change something in your network, and pretend that you will get tens or several orders of magnitude more information than before. Yeah.
Just to fully understand this work by Solari et al., was that including noise or not?
Yes. So this is assuming that you have independent cells, mm-hmm. But it's homogeneous. So this is assuming that this has a homogeneous population of neurons. But people have tried to extrapolate really too much these results, and this is what I'm stressing here. So, brief summary, spiky neural networks transmit virtually all input information, and noise decorrelation does not improve information. So, what is limiting information then? So, what is the ultimate reason the brain may have finite information about the sensory variable? People like Shadlin and Newson has proposed that the shared connectivity is what limits information. And but again, we know that this is not true because, I mean, shared connectivity, for those that you don't know, is essentially you have different layers of neurons, and you have shared connectivity because you have pretty much the same number of neurons in all these layers. So there is no way that you can have dense connectivity without sharing connectivity. There is no way of doing that in this type of topology. And it was assumed that because of this topology of this network, then automatically you will lose information or you have quite a little bit of information. But we know that this is not the case because with the previous analysis, we know that regardless of the connectivity, namely regardless of connect densely or sparsely this network, you will get that all information is passing through in the network. So, I mean, it was straightforward, but we wanted to show numerically that it was the case. So we created a two-layer network, input network with n neurons and output network with n neurons, and we connected every neuron here with a fraction f of presynaptic neurons randomly. And because of that, you have shared connectivity. There is some chance, some probability of sharing the same presynaptic links here. The correlation coefficient as a function of the size of this network was 0.1, and this correlation coefficient is coming from the fact that there is shared connectivity. Because they have shared connectivity, these neurons tend to do something similar. But again, when you compute the information rate from the network itself, or the open circles, and you compare with the prediction with the total input information that you have in the input, these two things match each other perfectly well. So clearly, shared connectivity
is the same as in forest. Is the variance of the recovered signal? What's the definition of this information rate? Okay. Is the efficient not the sham?
It's efficient information. It's the inverse of the minimal values of the optimal decoder. So shared connectivity does not limit information. But then the question is, what is limiting information? So ultimately, if you have independent cells. You have independent cells in your brain, you will have tons and tons of information. We know that this is not the case. Either there is a huge amount of information loss at some point, or the brain is doing something really, really stupid if it has tons of information. So, in other words, the only way that the brain can lose information or it may have limited information is because neurons are correlated. But as I've described to you before, it's not because of the size of the correlation. The size of the correlation doesn't matter. But of course, it has to be some type of correlations that limit information. And the question, the ultimate question, is what are these type specific correlations that actually limit information? So we have answered this question, and the intuitive description of how of the type of correlations that these information limiting correlations are is as follows. So variability or correlations that limit information look like this. So let me explain you what this is. So this is plotting here activity as a function of a preferred stimulus of a population. So this is a population of neurons, and each neuron prefers different orientations of the grating or different features of the stimulus. And what I'm plotting here is the activity of this population of neurons in red for a particular stimulus. So this neuron, this population is responding to a particular stimulus, and this is the activity that you see. Ideally, you should be able to record it experimentally and see that it's something like that. So variability in this population that limits information about the encoded stimulus S is something that wiggles the activity profile like that from trial to trial in this way. So in a second trial, for exactly the same stimulus, you will have activity pattern that will look something like that. So essentially the same population activity that has been wiggled, shift to the right. And in a different trial, you will have exactly the same activity pattern that has been shifted to the left and back and forth in random ways, in a predictable way. So fluctuations of activity that look something like that are going to be the only ones that limit information in your piece of cortex that you're looking at. So, but this is like a very intuitive way of these correlations, but we want to know more features about these correlations, how these correlations look like. So for that, we plot here the correlation coefficient as a function in preferred stimulus of two neurons. So two neurons that are here nearby, they tend to prefer the same stimulus. Okay? So these two blue neurons here, they tend to prefer this stimulus. And these two neurons, across trials, the variability goes together. So if the population activity shifts to the right, the activity of these two neurons go down simultaneously. And if the activity here moves to the left, the activity of these two neurons is going to go up. So for neurons that they have similar tuning, similar stimulus preferences, the correlation coefficient is going to be positive. But if you look at neurons like this blue one and this red one here, that are on the two sides of this population activity hill, the correlations are going to look they're going to be negative because wiggling of this activity hill is going to create negative reductions of activity here, but positive increases of activity there. So essentially, this is going to create negative correlation. So this is the type of correlations that actually limit information. So a little bit more intuitively and mathematically, you can think of a population activity like a point in a multidimensional space where your space is the space of activities or spike counts in your population. So it will be like a highly dimensional space. And a stimulus, on average, defines a point in this space. And as you change the stimulus, this defines a one-dimensional manifold. This can be a convoluted line in this space. And this will happen, this is the activity, the mean activity, as a function of the stimulus. Correlations or variability in the activity that is going to limit information are going to be those that move the activity, in other words, the point, from trial to trial along this one-dimensional manifold. And the intuition is that when that happens, variations of the activity from trial to trial are going to be confounded by changes of the activity of the stimulus itself. This is a little bit confusing, but because there are several graphs. So essentially, these are different ways of looking at the same thing. And maybe you understand one of them and not the other, but there are different and complementary ways of looking exactly at the same type of correlation. And when these correlations, this variability that moves along this one-dimensional line are projected onto the tangent, actually what you find is the differential correlations have this mathematical expression. So any covariance matrix structure, any structure of correlations in your network that limit the information is going to be the sum of two contributions. One contribution that doesn't limit information, plus another contribution, which is the product of the derivatives of the tuning curves. And this expands a full matrix. Okay? So this is the mathematical result, and we can prove that the only type of correlations that limit information about S, if you have different type of correlations that they don't look something like this, they won't limit information as your network is very large. Yes?
So if you would have a monotonic activity curve, you would not get this behavior, correct?
No, you will get the behavior, but then the monotonic, you mean increasing, for instance? Yeah, no, you will get exactly the same thing because then you will define the tuning curve. So actually, this is a vector of tuning curves, what you will call the tuning curve, which is the average activity of a neuron as a function of the stimulus. You will get all of these entries, and this is arbitrary. So this can be for a bell-shaped distributions, tuning curve, sorry. It can be like a monotonic tuning curve. So you just take the derivative of that Turing curve, whatever it is, at the value s, and you create these metrics. You expand these metrics with these two vectors, and these are the correlation metrics that is going to limit your information about s. You put something else different here, it's not going to limit information.
It doesn't fit into your image that you show like that.
Well, this will hold for this type of Turing curves, of course.
If
the Turing curves were like he mentioned, it would be essentially like something that ramps up, and then it will be, the idea of wiggling will be exactly the same. So you will shift it back and forth. So the particular shape of this depends on the Turing curve. Well, this is much more general. This is just different, a one-dimensional manifold, whatever it is, and fluctuations of your activity that limit information are going to be those that move you from along this one-dimensional manifold, whatever it is. And when you project to the tangent, then you get this this type of correlation. When you project to the tangent, you take the derivative of f with respect to s, and you get this type of correlation projected onto that tangent. So this is a very general result. So you can play with it, and you won't find, if you plug a slightly different vector here, different from f, you won't limit information. So it actually has to be dead on this direction. So essentially, the covariability in your activity has to go exactly in this direction. If it's in any other direction, then it doesn't limit information. So it's a unique, it's quite unique. So we have specified the uniqueness of this correlation. So, and you may wonder why I put this in this way, and why I do use an epsilon here. So for us, when you put an epsilon, it means that it can be very small. And this is the interesting property of this type of correlations, that they can be very small. They can be very small, but they can play a very, very important role. And this is a very important message. So this can be very small compared to other type of correlations, like global modulations of your activity in your cortex, any other type of correlations, that they don't look like the derivatives of the Turing curve, the products of the derivatives of the Turing curve. This could happen, and essentially you won't see these correlations, but they're going to be playing a very important role, as you can see next. So this is what we did here. We created a neural network based on the definition of the Turing curve. So it was a Poisson network. So here we didn't generate the dynamics itself. You just plug the tuning curve that we want in this population. And we created two networks, the red network and the blue network. And you may wonder, well, what's the difference between these two networks? They look pretty much identical. I don't see anything here. So this is the correlation function as a function of the difference in the preferred direction or stimulus of the neurons. You remember neurons that are at the same stimulus at zero, they tend to have a higher correlation. And then this decays, it flattens off. This is something that you will see experimentally, yeah, very typically. So what's the difference between these two? Actually, what I did is I took to create the correlations in the blue network. What I did is taking the correlations in the red network and adding a very tiny amount of differential correlations of this type of correlations, a very, very small amount. And when I did that, the effects on information are really dramatic. So here we compute efficient information from these two types of networks. And when there is no these differential correlations, the red network, information grows without any limits. So you will get, as you increase the size of your network, you will get more and more information and non-stop. But as soon as you introduce this very tiny amount of correlations that you will have a hard time to see it experimentally, to detect it experimentally, this simulation corresponds to thousands of trials, something that you won't get typically in experiments. So you won't see difference here, but you will see that information for that particular network, information rapidly saturates as a function of neurons, of the neuron. So just a tiny amount of differential correlations really makes a drastic difference in terms of how much information the network has about the sensory variable. So the only information limiting correlations are differential correlations, which are proportional to the product of the derivatives of the tuning curve. And this is this spanning this matrix. So if you remember, we started with this discussion, with this debate. And we claimed that it was a very interesting, and people find this debate very, very interesting because, yeah, you want to know whether there is a lot of weak synchrony or almost no synchrony in your network. Looks like a very, very interesting question. But we know that actually the size of the collisions don't matter. It doesn't matter. What matters is the presence of some tiny, that can be potentially tiny correlations that have a specific shape, nothing to do with the size, the overall size of the correlation, that really kills you. And the problem is how to detect this. I mean, if they are very, very small, the question now is how we are going to detect this, this correlation. No? This is like a really hard theoretical physics where you predict something that is impossible to discover because it requires the energy of the whole universe to run the experiment. So it looks like something like that. No? It's, we are predicting the existence of something that can be really, very, very tiny, but actually makes a huge effect when it comes to information processing, which is something that the animals do care. So in effect, actually, we can see this the effect. So it's like in a good experimental physics physics experiment, maybe you cannot see directly, but you can see the effect. And that will be good enough for now. So this is actually what we have here. So we can see their effects. And we can see their effects, and this is probably the only second equation that I'm going to write. This is the linear Fisher information that you can extract. This is the linear Fisher information. And you may want to compute this information from real data, from true data, not from simulations that we have done before, but now you have your recordings, and you want to know how much information is there about something, okay, about the orientation of a gradient, about the color, or the speed of a moving object, whatever you want. And in the literature, there are two ways of computing that information that is introduces very, very strong biases. And we're going to propose using a method that is a little bit more robust to these biases. So one way that you can go is just to estimate directly this number. So you just compute the tuning curves of the cells and require some trials. Then you take the derivative of the tuning curve, a little bit tricky because it depends on how do you interpolate the points, et cetera, et cetera. Then you compute the covariance matrix of your data. And then you have to compute the inverse of that. So this becomes a little bit tricky now because this can be 100 by 100 dimensions. So it can be a little bit tricky. And this is what is happening. When you use this direct estimate of information for several variations that I'm going to describe, you gain strong biases. And actually, you even for large amounts of trials, you will be getting biases. So for instance, for a direct estimate, for 4,000 trials, if you plot information as a function of number of neurons, you will see that this information scales up without limits, when in reality the true information doesn't saturate. The qualitative conclusion will be completely missed if you use this type of analysis and you draw conclusions for this type of plot. But there is something that you can do. What you can do is using decoders. A decoder is a way of trying to predict the stimulus. And by definition, the performance of your decoder cannot be beyond the information that you have about the stimulus. So the performance of any decoder is going to give you a lower bound as to how much information you have. So it's going to give you a lower bound. The good thing is that in many occasions, this lower bound can be very tight, can be very close to the true information. And this is what we see here. So this is information as a function of a number of neurons for different amount of trials. And pretty much, we're very close to the true information with not so many trials. So by using decoders, in this case, just simple linear decoders, logistic regression, will be quite good enough. So this is like a take-home message, don't be too smart and trying to compute things from what you will do it mathematically, but try to use the machine learning tools that are available now, and they're a little bit much robust to this type of questions. So yes, differential collisions can be detected by their effects on information. So that's good. Let me conclude and then. So we have seen that the spiking neural networks transmit virtually all input information, surprising result, because spiking networks are nonlinear, highly nonlinear. The implication of this result is that noisy correlation does not improve information. So you shouldn't care much about whether the overall size of the synchronization is high or low. we know that circonnectivity does not limit information, but what you should care is about some specific type of correlations or synchrony, which are called differential correlations, and they are the only information-limited correlations that you can find. And they have this specific shape. The derivatives, the product of the derivatives of the tuning curves respect to the variable that you want to, from what you want to get, how much information is there. And finally, differential correlations can be very weak, almost unnoticeable at the correlation level, but their effect can be seen at the information level. This is good news because we can see the effects of these correlations that can be very tiny, and they can be buried under another unstructured type of correlations or type of synchrony in your network. So two main messages: the size of correlation does not matter. Information limiting correlations are differential correlations. So let me thank the collaborators of for this particular work I talked to you to today: Alex Puget, Inmar Kanisadar, Peter Lathan, Jeff Beck, and Sad Pico. I would like to thank comments by Jan Drugovic, and I'm going to introduce my group in Barcelona: Inigo, Ramon, and Philippe, two three very talented PhD students, and a postdoc with us, Alexander Yafil. And we are a theoretical group, but we have very, very tight collaborations with experimentalists from where we get experimental data. And actually, we are trying to predict, to test some of the predictions of this theoretical analysis with Mavi Sanchez-Vives in Barcelona, Dan Cohn in New York, and Mathieu Ruiz. And thank you very much for your attention.
Classifiers, you extract the information or the differential correlations from logistic regression or linear regression, whatever. And you also, what you see as these differential correlations is in the learning would be considered the specificity that you can get in the differentiations or something like a generalization property.
Mm-hmm.
So in the end, all this for me is a framework of simply extending the machine learning concept to saying we add some noise. Would you agree on that?
Not really. So here, the achievements of this work are kind of like twofold. On the one hand, we want to understand, we want to set or help to disambiguate some debate that is in the literature about the role of correlations and synchronization. And probably you know in the literature they have been playing this game of asking the question of I create this neural network, and this is a very theoretically oriented question, so this is not machine learning, it's a theoretically oriented question. I create a neural network, I put in some tuning curves, I put in some correlations, and I want to know whether these correlations are good or bad for information. I mean, there is tons of work by Son Polinsky, Alex Puget, many others. We have just been playing with this game of like a highly unconstrained game by trial and error, trying to figure out what are the correlations that are bad and the correlations that are good, so to speak. But this game is endless. I mean, you can try thousands of different manipulations. And now, what the contribution that we have now is that that game has ended. So we know now the type of correlations that are going to limit information. So you shouldn't go more in this theoretical analysis. So that's the first contribution, which is like quite theoretically oriented, and I think it's quite interesting. And then I see your point that some of the messages here from this talk are going in the direction of using tools that are very well known by the machine learning people. And this is, it's good to acknowledge this. I mean, that there are tools that have been developed.
But it's not only the tools, your whole setup with the input information, the network that you use, which represents the hidden layer, only adding some noise, and the extraction of the information by linear classifiers is the machine learning concept.
Well, reservoir computing.
extreme learning, many of them support mechanisms.
But whenever you talk about information, it's there are very little ways of defining. I mean, you have channel information, feature information. That doesn't matter. So this is very, you know, but I wouldn't say that this is a machine learning problem. I mean, it's a problem that every being is facing. It's like trying to understand, extract information and find a structure in that information.
Maybe that the machine learning represents very well what the brain does.
Well, from a machine learning perspective, you would have said the question is not really well posed in how far the correlations limit the information extraction. It's not the correlation which matter. It's in the end the generalization property that you obtain in the distinction of the output states. So what in the end defines your coding space. So that's why the motivation I see very well coming. And I don't want to I don't mean it negatively. I mean it's an important point because it introduces.
No, that there are contributions from.
It introduces the importance of noise and their correlations. Into this machine learning concept, which usually neglect this aspect.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I know. Our field, there is a huge amount of people, like Claudio, like really many people, like were really focusing on the dynamical aspects, and less so people who are trying to break barriers and going in these two, playing these two camps at the same time, like machine learning, like trying to understand information and dynamics. I mean, these two camps seems to be a little bit segregated so far. And at some point, we have to meet. And I mean, I appreciate that you see this like a contribution in that direction, like putting questions and that may be interested for both. And of course, we have to advance. I mean, there are here limitations in terms of for instance, what is, of course, when you have a really rapidly changing signals, like for instance, cortex, probably this setup doesn't work so well in this when you are just facing the time constants of the network of your system. Then this the linear analysis or linear decoders, maybe they're not good enough, and you need more complicated decoders that use spike timing or relative spike timing or these kind of things, and we should go also in that direction. But I found it kind of interesting to set the status in for a particular field, which is the vision field, which is more steady state.
Well, you might know the work by Danko Nikolic, who has actually been using exactly what you're doing in the experimental scheme with anesthetized cat, recording 15 neurons, and reproducing information, reconstructing stimuli from a linear classifier.
I know the work, yeah.
Is this work telling something about the how should a good tuning curve be? So it's telling us how, if the actual tuning curves observed in real brains, real neurons, are they in some sense good or are bad? Or, so what would be an optimal tuning curve? Because a linear.
Okay, so what this is telling you is that the optimal tuning curves are not set by information constraints. It's set by some other constraints. It can be energetic, it can be other type of constraints or location, spacing of the cells, many other constraints that are beyond the information constraint. Because what we have shown here is that for quite general spiking networks, regardless of the connectivity matrix, which means regardless of the tuning curve and regardless of the type of covariability, you can get all information through. So in terms of information per se, there is no an advantage. The other question, another interesting question, is how do you then pack this information somewhere in your network so that you can send this information somewhere else? And if you want to pack this information, maybe there's a different constraint now. You want to just send a few axons to in a sparse way to another region, so it enters the notion of packing information. But no information per se. If you have the information of your, if you can read out the network, it doesn't really matter your shape of tuning curve. So we cannot tell anything about what is the optimal shape of tuning curve, because when it comes to information, it doesn't really matter. So you have to tell me what are the other interesting constraints that are relevant for the design of the system. But it's a good question because it really tells that you should look for other constraints.
Any other question? Because we're already in the late. If not, let's thank him again.